the worship in a minute anyway. So let's just pray. And Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us here. In your grace, in your mercy, Lord, you just continuously carry us. Just as we heard this song, you cover us. You give us light. There are just so many things you do for us that we are not even sure, Lord, how we are standing here today. You sustain us. And you're just an amazing God, Lord. We have no words to describe who you are and what you are for us and what you do for us. All we can do in some mere human ways, in simple ways, that is within our understanding, we try to do things that we think will please you. And that is our prayer today, Lord, that the songs we sing, the prayers we pray, the word that we share with each other and we learn together from your word, let all of those things be somehow pleasing unto you. Let those things be how your name would be glorified, your name would be lifted high. And Lord, just that we would be decreasing every moment, that we would just make ourselves unexistent. We would decrease, and that you would increase in all things that we do, Lord. So give us that humble heart. Give us that heart that, as we learned last week, deny us and deny our needs and deny our lives, but that we would live for Christ. And that we would find gain in living for Christ. And that even if we die, it would be it would be all for Christ. So thank you again, Lord, for making that clear to those of us who are here right now. Because we've put everything aside in the world and what the world has to offer, and we are here right now at your feet, Lord. We are here to listen to you, what you want to communicate to us today. We want to just learn something from your word. We want to grow in fellowship with each other, because as important it is that we have a relation with you, Lord, you also want a horizontal relation as well as a vertical relation, Lord, with other people, other believers. So I pray, Lord, that we would make that connection, not only with the people here, but as we extend ourselves into the world. So thank you again. Bless the rest of the time. Bless the throats, the voices that are singing such beautiful songs. Bless the hands that are playing these instruments. Bless those who are sitting here and listening and joining in. And we also want to pray for a blessing upon those who are walking outside on the street right now. As this sound falls on their ear, Lord, I would want to have a special prayer that you lead somebody. It may be one person, but he may be planned to be here today within this group. And I pray, Lord, that you would draw that one person, maybe more in your abundance, into this worship so that person may come to know about you. Thank you again, Lord. We surrender ourselves to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Okay, so let us do some good worship. I'm ready. Be prepared to sing it twice. If we have people join later, we'll have to catch up.
Yeshu Tera Adam, song is about the battle we are in. The day we accepted Jesus Christ, we are in the battle against flesh, Satan and sin. But the good thing is, like, the battle is already won by Christ. I mean, the war. I mean, we may lose battle here and there, but the ultimate war is already won. And we need not forget that the battle we are fighting against our enemies is already belongs to the Lord, and the Lord gives the victory.
Yeshua, Lord, this is the name of the
In chemistry, you talk about all these plagues and miracles, In chemistry, Jesus turned water into wine. Right? We know that story. In biology, think about it, he was born without a natural or a normal conception. So he defied the laws of biology. In physics, he disproved the law of gravity when he was raised, ascended into heaven, and then when he walked on water. Right? So he's above the laws of physics. I mean, he can walk on water. In economics, you guys know the laws of economics? Guess what? Economics says that, you know, this much supply and this much demand, and this is how things go together. But he defied the laws of economics, and he fed 5,000 people with only 5 loaves of bread and 2 pieces of fish. So in economics, he also, is above that law. In medicine, you take medicine, we were talking earlier about being an RN or being a nursing or physician's assistant. In medicine, he cured many without administering a single dose of medicine or a dose of drugs. No injections over there, it's kind of painless, right? And in history, we're talking about all the different subjects. So in history, he's the beginning, he's the end. It's all about Jesus. You know, it's calculated that about 100 billion people have lived on earth and died. 100 billion, so far, maybe more, because this may have been an older number, but 100 billion people have lived and died on earth. Today, about 6.8, maybe close to 7 billion, maybe you guys might know exact number, are alive, but who knows how many more, like, yet to be born. But regardless, there is nobody like Jesus. And that's what we have to remember. He is, he was, he is to come, he has no past, no future, he is eternally present. So he is here today, and I welcome you in the presence of Jesus Christ. I want to invite you next Saturday. As MGM, we are going to invite Greg Laurie. No, we are going to go to Greg Laurie's ministry in Harvest. It is in the Angel Stadium at 4:30. I believe we are going to meet at 4:30, even though the event starts at 7, but it gets crowded. I know how it works. So those of you who want to carpool or go with us, because it's $15 for parking, so we can make less numbers of car. I would like to take Royce with us if he's available, and anybody else that wants to join. Honest, you can bring all the children, like Nishit and them. I think I'm just making that announcement with you. Whoever wants to go will carpool. If God willing, we can do something with a 15-seat van or something, we'll see. But if not, at least we'll try to minimize the cars. So that is my brief announcement of what is happening. Actually, it is happening Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. But we are planning to go on Saturday, which is the 29th. And we will be going through this Harvest Crusade as a group together in fellowship. So we plan to meet there about 4:30 or 5, and you can take some of this information. There are some more cards, I would imagine. Okay, and it's going to be Jesus. It's not Great Glory, it is not MGM, it is not Phil Wickham, it is not, I can't even pronounce his name, Jeremy Campbell, I can pronounce. How do you say it? Pray. Anyway, so it's not about any of those, it's about Jesus. Okay, so with that, I want to pray especially today for Brianti's mom. She's in the ER. But besides that, do we have any other prayer requests that, yes?
My mom is not doing good.
Oh, Lalita Gadi, okay.
She was in ER last Saturday.
Okay, where is she today?
Home? She's home, but
not well.
I just came from.
Okay, we'll pray for her health. Okay. How is Francis? He's good. All things taken care of? Or like, you are doing good? Okay. So the praise is that the Lord provides. And the Lord kept him safe. They had a very severe accident. His father, or their father, and they totaled their car. But they were, he's okay, which is important. And I'm so thankful that you guys are here in spite of all of that. Any other prayer requests? Oh, Joel Kant, Reverend Joel Kant is in an accident, we heard this morning. He was trying to cross the road, somebody hit him, like a car hit him, and he's got like fracture on the right side or something like that. So we will pray for him as well. Yeah, we left him a message, so I couldn't talk to him to exactly know what is wrong, but at least we can keep him in prayer. Anything else? Anyone else? School? Okay, pray for people who start school. Okay, and some of you, not just one, I know many of you start school. Some have already started. Okay, what else? Anything else? Before I pray, anybody wants to share something about Jesus? Anyone? You can say it from there. You don't have to come up here if you're shy. Anyone? What do you guys think? Has anybody been brought out of Egypt lately? Anybody has had to put blood on their doorpost and they got saved? That's what these plagues are about. It's kind of cool. We're going to talk about the 9 plagues, not the 10th one, where they lose the firstborn. But so thanks to Glory for getting all 9 on one. Okay, guys, if nobody has anything to share, then I will pray. Anyone? Final chance? I'm thankful, Shri Sankal, you are with us. Praise God for that. And keep us in our prayer. As you can see, the wonderful job and the music, and we just want to praise God for that. Okay, let us pray without further ado, and we can continue our service. Heavenly Father, thank you again so much for who you are, and what you have done in our lives, and what you will be doing. We know, Lord, that you plan exciting things for our life, each one of us individually, as well as in the life of MGM, as well as in the lives of other ministries that are in Los Angeles area and everywhere all around the world. We just talked about 7 billion people, Lord, and at least 1-something billion we know are acknowledging Christianity as a religion. I pray, Lord, that all of them would truly receive Jesus as their Savior, truly would accept Jesus Christ as the Messiah, as the Son of God, and that the sacrifice He has made to open the doors to heaven and promise of salvation, Lord, that we would accept that gift. And I just want to pray especially for all of those who know this and yet have not affirmed, yet have not believed, yet have not confessed with their tongues that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. Because your word says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. So Lord, today we want to confess that you are our Lord. You are our Savior. And in your name, everything is possible. And all of these requests that we just talked about, especially for Mithi Dali, Lord, we want to pray. For Guni Auntie, we want to pray, Lord, that we see healing in their life. For Mithi Dali, at this age, it is difficult to go through this hardship, Lord, and we pray a special blessing upon her, Lord, that you would completely heal her and you would provide the needs that she might have physically, emotionally, in every which way, Lord. And the same thing we pray for Lalita Dali, Lord, as well. At her age also, we just know that how enthusiastic she is about you and how eager she is always to share about you. And we have seen her testimony, we have heard her testimony. And I pray, Lord, that you would get her back on her 2 feet so she can continue doing the work that you have assigned her. That the last commission that you have of go to the ends of the world, Lord, that she would be fulfilling that even till her last breath, Lord. And we pray that you would just get her back in that routine that she is used to doing. And we also pray for all the Sinatra like that as well, Lord. We want to pray for Francis Bai, Lord, who had met with an accident. And as we see, amazingly, you have provided. As we see that he was kept safe, which is the most important thing, because the material things can be replaced, but we are just thankful that he is safe. We're thankful for his family and their dedication, that in spite of all the difficulties and the things that normally, routinely, they would have to do, they are here diligently and worshiping you and leading the worship. So we're thankful for that. We're thankful for the McMahon family and all of these family members who are leading us in this wonderful worship, Lord. I want to ask a special ounce of blessing upon them. I want to ask a blessing upon the children, Lord, especially like Royce and Mission and Aaron, and even for others who may be starting college and in higher studies, Lord. I want to bring all of them into your care. And I pray, Lord, that this summer may have been a little relaxed time. This summer may have been a time for break. This summer may have been time that their minds are occupied with other things. But as now they enter into this time of study, I pray, Lord, that they will be able to focus, that they would be able to remember, that they would be able to just stay away from all those distractions that the world has to offer, and that they would be very successful in what they are studying for. All the degrees that they want to achieve and attain, that they would get those degrees under their belt. And the reason, Lord, why we ask for that is that today, in this day and age, we are in need of Christian leaders. And I want to pray, Lord, that these students who are studying and moving forward would someday become leaders, Christian leaders in our communities, Lord, and that your word would be powerful again in this community and in this society. Lord, I want to pray a special blessing upon the people who are walking up and down the street on Pioneer Boulevard, on 183rd, and all the other side streets, Lord. Today we are going to talk about idols. Today we are going to talk about people who worship other man-made gods. And I know, Lord, that some of these people out there are tied up into that. It's almost like a slavery where they're believing into their own man-made gods instead of worshiping the one true God. Lord, I would pray that you would use our ministry as well as any other means for breaking this spell from these people's eyes, that they would be free from that bondage of idolatry and they would know this one true God. Lord, it is such a perfect location, Lord, that they can just walk into this church. And as we prayed earlier, I pray that even that one soul that you want to win today would walk in here today and hear your message and know more about you, Lord, and want to know more about you as well, Lord. So thank you again. Thank you for each one of us that is present here. Thank you for giving us that mind that we want to learn and know more about you. And I pray, Lord, that in the next few minutes, Lord, what you want to share with us, what you want to tell us, we would grasp it and apply it in our lives as we move forward in our lives, Lord. So thank you again for giving us this opportunity. I humble myself, Lord, because it is not me, Lord, but it is your word that I want to share, and what you have shown me in your word, I would like to bring to these people, and I pray that I do a good job, a job that would glorify your name. So please bless me, Lord, and anoint me with a special blessing for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. I'm going to switch the PowerPoint to another one.
So this is the short version, 9 out of 10.
Let's first of all read just one verse that I want to focus on today. And then we can, I don't want us to be reading 5 chapters, because I remember in my email I told you that we are going to talk about chapter 6 verse 28 through chapter 10 verse 29. And it's basically, everybody knows that story, right? We just want to know what that story is going to mean to us today. But we're going to focus on chapter 7 verse 5. Exodus chapter 7 verse 5. That is what we're going to focus on. So when you have that, let me know and we can read it together. Exodus chapter 7 verse 5. That is the center of all these big long chapters that we're going to cover. Try to cover today briefly. Okay. Exodus chapter 7 verse 5 in my Bible says this, and you can follow along or join. It says, "And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it." Okay. So it is something that the Lord is saying, and it is intended for the Egyptians to know who one true God is. Okay. So keep our focus on that, what God is planning. As we do that, I want you to just kind of get a picture of what Egypt was all about. We're going to talk a little bit about that. As you can see, I don't have a pointer in here, but Egypt was pretty much desert except for the River Nile that flows through it. River Nile was the lifeline of Egypt, if you can say that. Especially the land that was given to the Israelites. Let me see if the other slide has that. Okay. Where it says this right here. Okay, Goshen. That Goshen is where Israelites were settled. So what you have to keep in mind, that the entire land of Egypt is going through these plagues, except for the land of Goshen. Goshen was, first of all, one of the fertile lands. That's what at least the Egyptians thought, because the Israelites were prospering, their flocks were multiplying, right? Their sheep and cattle were multiplying. But it was a blessing of God. There is no different land from that to the other side of the Nile or whatever. But this is basically, and there are your nine plagues that we're talking about. The tenth one we won't talk about today. But I want you to keep that picture in mind as we go forward. So give me some time. We're going to cover a lot of ground, and I'm going to try to do it as quick as possible. So this lesson can be divided in three parts. First lesson is where Moses is coming to meet the Pharaoh for the second time. We already know the first time, right? First time he was like drop kick. Pharaoh just says, "Who are you? What are you talking about? I am the God." And then the people were given more work, the people were punished, and then the people turned against Moses. So last week we talked about what happens when you want to be a leader and your own people turn against you. What happens? We talked about that briefly. And we talked about dying to self. Anyway, that was one. This is the second meeting. And then the second thing from chapter 7 through verses 10 is the first nine plagues in full detail. We won't go in that much detail, but I want to draw some things out of it. And then the main portion, or the main point I want to keep in focus about Pharaoh's hardened heart. Hardened heart is a big problem today in life. A lot of people know something, they believe something, but they don't act upon it. Think about it, you know what I'm talking about? They'll be like, "Well, I know that if I take this road, it's a shortcut. And I know there will be less traffic. But you know what? I'm going to try this other route." And as soon as they turn the other route, there's an accident, there's some construction, there's a traffic. And that's what it is. We know something is right, and we don't follow that. And that is what Pharaoh's situation was. So God is speaking, that verse that we talked about, God is speaking about all these plagues on Egypt as a judgment on gods of Egypt. Okay? He said, "I will bring judgment on all gods of Egypt. I am the Lord," it says in Exodus 12. Okay. Now, I want you to draw your attention also to another chapter. What happens in our life today? Putting on the armor of God when we are talking about dealing with God. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 13 says this way. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, you can stand." Even in the book, in the Word of God, it talks about our fight is against the dark, spiritual, and other kind of evil powers. So the existence is there. Sometimes we say there are no other gods. Sometimes we say there is only one God. Why should we worry about other gods? But this battle that God is fighting through Moses is against other gods. And I want you to see who these gods are. In Romans 1, Paul talks about how humans suppress the knowledge about the existence of one true God. And in Romans 1:20, it says that, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, His eternal power, and divine nature have been clearly seen." When I see a rainbow in the sky, when I see a beautiful colors in the sky, when I see a waterfall, when I see the birds flying back to their nest, I think there is a God. Some people actually say, if you just look at your thumb and the way it is created, you would think, you would know that this is not an ordinary design. It just didn't happen by accident. And God has to be present. It is said that if mankind lost its thumb, for some reason we didn't have our thumbs, mankind would be out of existence in a few years. That is how important this thumb is. And if so, try it one day with tying it away or something like that. Try to live without it, see what happens. So it is very important that we know the existence of God, and we acknowledge that, and we understand that, because we have no excuse. Today in the morning service, we were talking about thankful to God. What are you thankful for? Some people said bringing to America, bringing us to America. And some people just said what was the word they used? That just keeping us alive or something like that. You know, and God is, what it was giving us birth in a Christian family. How many of you are thankful for giving us birth in a Christian family? I am. You know why? Because I'm a very stubborn man. I'm going to tell you something. If I was born in any other culture, if I was born in any other religion, and somebody came to my doorstep, I want to tell you about Jesus, I'd be like, yeah, right. I am my God. Who are you to tell me about Jesus? Let me tell you about my God. You know, you have to go up on the mountain on your knees and elbows, and when you go up there, I can't even believe what I'm saying. But anyway, okay? But I would be believing that. If I was born in that, okay, and if from the childhood I was told that this is how it is, I would have been very strong in that belief. So yes, I am very thankful, and I agree with the person who said, thank you God for giving us birth in a Christian family. So, but now we are, that is not done. Our job is not done because you're born in a Christian family. The work begins after you're born. So anyway, that's the hard part. So, okay, we are going to talk about the place. So here we go, a little more on that same map. Okay. On the left side, if you can read those letters, I hope they're big enough, that's the type of the plague that God pronounced upon Egypt, and the right side is a corresponding Egyptian god or goddess that, you know, corresponds to that plague. So the first plague was water turning into blood, Egypt, and it is reflected, and it is against a god called Hapi. Of course, what a name, right, for God? Egyptian god of the Nile. Okay, so we're going to talk about that a little bit, what it does, what it means. So, the first plague, let's see, we'll just get right to the plagues. Okay, Nile turned to blood. The first plague was against the waters of Egypt. God sent Moses and Aaron to meet the Pharaoh at the banks of River Nile, possibly when he was worshipping the river. How many of you know people worship at the river, right? You've seen that. So Pharaoh was probably worshiping, not at the river, but he was worshiping the river. Okay. Since Pharaoh did not heed to God's command, he didn't believe, that let my people go was a command from God, he didn't believe, God pronounced a judgment, and the waters turned into blood. The fish in the river died, and the river smelled so bad. It was that way for almost like a week's period, it says, that the Egyptians could not drink the water. Anyway, who would want to drink water that looks like blood? Anyway, but they could not drink it. Blood was everywhere in Egypt. This river, even today, as I showed you in the first picture, it is the most important thing for the existence of the people in Egypt. A lot of the gods and goddesses were out of the river Egypt. Out of the river Nile, because it was so important. Osiris, there was another god. He was like the bloodstream. They called the god of the bloodstream. There was a god called Khnum, and he was the guardian of the Nile. Hapi, as I said, is the essence or the spirit of Nile. And there were others like Hapimun and Taurit, and of course the fish. The fish, they also considered God. There were some gods shaped like fish, but none of those gods could do anything when the river was turned into death. Fish died, water turned red. These gods, if they were gods, had no power against our God. So Pharaoh's heart, although after all of that, hardened, and he said he's not going to let the people go. So we're going to go to the second plague. Second plague is about frogs coming out of the Nile River. Okay? And the god that they were referring to was called Heket, an Egyptian goddess of fertility, water, renewal, and so forth. And that is what the second one was about, the frogs. The land was overrun with frogs. Now, I know some cultures, they might be happy, frogs, food, but maybe not in every case, especially when you think of that as a god. I mean, there was too much God, everywhere there was God, and it was kind of a dangerous. They multiplied abnormally, everywhere they turned, you open a closet, you open a drawer, you open something, kitchen cabinet, lift a pot, it's like, it was a frog. I mean, it was just a weird picture. The entire land was overrun by them. When Aaron stretched his hand over Nile, frogs came out of the water, and they were in the palace, they were in the bedrooms, they were in the beds, they were in the houses of the officials, in the ovens, in all possible places. And one of the gods, this Heket, who were pictured, with the body of frog and all that, he was the one God was, silencing at this time. So since the Egyptians worshipped frogs, as we do cows in India, right, something like that, they could not be killed. Right? In India, I've heard that you cannot touch a cow. Even if it's blocking the road, you will sit there till the road is clear. Can you imagine all these frogs? They're all over you, but you can't do anything. Oh, God. You can't hit a God, right? So you can't. I mean, this is ridiculous. Now, interesting thing was this. Every time Moses did a miracle, God's powered miracle, the Pharaoh's magicians tried to imitate. So guess what? They did the same trick and brought more frogs. But that was not what was needed. What was needed was the frogs to go away. So what is the use of performing a trick and bringing more frogs? They could not make the frogs go away. Only Moses, when he prayed, and when Pharaoh begged to Moses to take the frogs away, Moses took that away, thinking that Pharaoh would now believe. But guess what? At the end of this plague, Pharaoh's heart was hardened, just like the Lord has said before. And I think I skipped some of that, but in the beginning, the Lord says that I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. Okay, next one. Plague number 3. Lice from the dust of the earth. And they affected the god called Jeb or Geb, Egyptian god of the earth. So in this plague, gnats, some kind of flies, came out of the dust. And that is what this plague was. And the God's judgment was against the god of the soil. We can call it God, but meaning the god that the Egyptians were worshipping. And the land brought insects, it kind of infected the people with different kind of plagues. The bodies of the priests became ceremonially unclean, when you have the mosquito bites and stuff like that. So since the priests were unclean because of these gnats, they could not perform any spiritual function. They could not do any of the spiritual worshiping that they could do. See, God indirectly stopped that, idol worship. For the first time, the Pharaoh's magicians in this plague could not duplicate what God's messengers had done. And here's the interesting thing. If you read in this case, it says that the magicians actually told Pharaoh that they see the finger of God in this plague. So some people have started realizing that it's not just a magic trick, it's something. But that didn't affect Pharaoh. So we go to number 4. Number 4, it says it's a swarm of flies. And it was against a god called Khipri, Egyptian god of creation, movement of the sun, and rebirth, and so forth. So the first two were against the water, and then the next 3 or 4 are against land. So again, this is kind of, out of the land came a swarm of flies. So this is a plague against the land, which brought all kinds of flying insects. And for the first time, the distinction between the regular Egypt, where the people live, and Goshen, where the Egyptians or the Israelites live. If you read this miracle or this plague, it says that there was no flies in the land of Goshen. Right? You would think that where there's a lot of cattle, there might be flies, but they were free of flies. Only in the land of Egypt. So it was a distinction that God brings to us, that He can control even the flies and insects, and they can only remain in the land where He wanted them to be affected. So the plague did not affect the Hebrews. You touch it, the fly god was worshipped, but the people could not tolerate the flies. There was a fly god, so when you see a fly, you would think, God, but they did not want to tolerate that. Okay, so he offers, so Pharaoh calls Moses and says, we want to compromise. Now think about it this way, sometimes we do this, right? When we have hardships, when we have some things going on that it starts getting a little bit difficult, the stages get a little higher, compromise. Let's say white flag, we talked about. So Pharaoh tries to compromise, and here's what he says, that people can worship Yahweh in Egypt. I'll let them worship, why don't they worship here? That's a compromise, right? Until now he was saying no. When Moses refused that, because that wasn't the plan of God, so Pharaoh offered that he would allow sacrifices in a nearby desert. Just go nearby, not too far, you can go and do some sacrifices. So Moses asked God to remove the flies when Pharaoh said he would let him go a little further. But as soon as the plague was gone, Pharaoh hardened his heart again. Okay, so next, we move on to the next plague. Number 5, I'm trying to go really quick here. Death of cattle and livestock. And it affected God called Heather, Egyptian goddess of love and protection. This is plague number 5, death of domestic animals. Horses, donkeys, camels, cattle, sheep, goats, all gone except for the livestock. Guess where? In Goshen. Right. All gone. Moses once again demanded to Pharaoh, let my people go that they may serve me, is what my God is asking. Revealing also the next Egyptian plague to occur on the condition of continued disobedience. So in a way, during this plague, Moses actually gives a warning to the Pharaoh and his people that if you don't let us go, it's going to get worse. So sometimes we have warnings, Pharaoh is having his warnings, and I won't go into our details right now, we know what it means, but let's just stay on this, the God story. So this plague was given with an advanced warning, allowing a period of repentance to occur. Sometimes we are warned about something, which is why God is asking us to repent. That's the idea. But I don't think Pharaoh or anybody was interested in that. Okay? Out of many animals that the Egyptians worship, they worship Heather, the cow goddess of fertility, for all her powers of life and procreation. And all of the powers that they thought this god had, he or she could not protect the animals from dying, or could not keep any of these plagues to stop. So one of the most popular cult was from this god. You know, we call cults today. Everybody understands cults, right? Cults are like people who follow something very like strongly and life or death kind of thing. This was a cult, and it was a cult called the Bull God. And the Egyptians believed that Apis came into being when a ray of sunlight impregnated a cow. Let me repeat this. There was a god called Apis, along with his Heather that they were worshipping. It was also a bull god or a cow god. The reason what they were saying that was a god is they thought a ray of a sun impregnated a cow. Okay, so they were believing that there was a miraculous birth and that was to be worshipped as a cow. So here's the third problem. This cow worship, guess where that came into play? Remember when they were going and when Moses was on Mount Sinai? Guess what people made? Down below. Cow. And people, some of the Egyptians did go with them. They said, here's my gold, here's my jewelry. You know, take all you want, but let's build this cow. Here's your God. And this is where this kind of worship can lead into. So even when we are in God's promise, sometimes when we allow those things to hang around, idol worship to hang around, it does lead us back into idol worship. We have to be very careful. The interesting thing here to note is that earlier plagues were kind of irritating, like, you know, flies, bugs, irritating. But this plague actually affected people's livelihood. Right? When you are a farmer, cattle, you know, it doesn't make you earn any income, so it is tough. But even then, the Pharaoh's heart did change. So number 6, Egyptian plague, ashes turned to boils and sores, and it was against Isis. Isis is a current name, I believe. Anyway, Egyptian goddess of medicine and peace. Okay, so here is an upgrade. Now the plague is upgrading. A higher level model, you know, like a LX, and now it is an SX, something, some luxury model of plague for them. It upgraded from affliction of animals to affliction of people. Okay, first time where people are being affected directly like that. So unannounced, the 6th plague, remember he was warned, so this plague came unannounced, and for the first time it directly affected the Egyptian people. Being instructed by the Lord, Moses took the ashes out of the worship, or where they worshiped at the furnace, and he threw them into the air, and the dust blew all over Egypt, and it settled on men and beasts and everyone alike, and anybody that got, or all of the people who got in contact with that ashes, started having boils or like gumdagan, right, sores, stuff like that. And as with the previous two, throughout the remaining Egyptian plagues, the division here is between Egypt, of the Egyptians and the children of Israel. They were not affected. They were not, you know, the severity of the judgment of God has now become personal. Now it is actually felt by people themselves, and they see the difference between God's chosen people and themselves. So this must have seemed ironic to the Egyptians, because here's the thing. In Egypt, the ashes of sacrifices were sprinkled in the air above the worshippers. You know, when the worshippers gathered, you know, we sometimes do something with the ash, right? I mean, that's a different story. But these people actually sprinkled the ashes when they were doing sacrifices. And it was considered as a blessing. So now the blessing is coming back as a curse, and it's because God was not in it. So the interesting thing that God, out of all these boils and sores, you know, if you guys know about Egypt, it was very advanced. It was one of the highest, like, cultured and richness-wise and every which way. Medically, it was one of, like, very well-known. It had medical skills like no other, you know, civilization had. But guess what? Those medical skills did not come into play. They were not able to heal themselves. There was a god called Imhotep, who was the guardian of the healing sciences. But where was he? He was nowhere in sight where this was going on. Where was the wisdom and the intervention that gods would normally play when their people are in danger? It didn't happen. Who was supposed to have power over these kind of miracles? That didn't happen. So as the painful boil spread, all Egypt saw powerlessness of the healing gods, yet Pharaoh refused to let the Israelites go. So we go to the next plague. It says, hail rained down in the form of fire. And the god that was affected, I don't know if that's a real, if I was a god, if I want that name, but it's called a Nut, Egyptian goddess of the sky. So god called Nut was affected by the hail. So thunder, hail, and lightning. The seventh plague was the first of the four directed against the god and goddesses of the sky. So the first two were against the river. The next four were against the land. Now we're going into directly against the sky and the gods and goddesses in the sky. Okay? So it did not hail in Egypt before this. There was hardly any rain in Egypt. Remember I said it was a desert? Okay? The city of Cairo, which was the capital of Egypt, has only 2 inches of rain annually. 2 inches of rain. Okay? There are years of no rainfall in some areas of Egypt, and the Bible says that the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt. Hail fell, lightning flashed back and forth. It was the worst storm Egypt had probably ever experienced, even since then. Hail struck everything in the fields, people, animals. The only place it did not hail, land of Goshen. I want to be there, where the Israelites were, okay, when they said. So the destruction brought the first break in public opinion. When it became this drastic, now the public is changing their opinion. Until now they are saying, Pharaoh or God, you're going to fall, right? Now there is a break in the public opinion. So some of the Egyptians, you know, who had the faith in the sky gods, they were like forever saying, you know, that's it, we don't believe in these gods. Okay, and those are the ones who probably joined Israelites when they left Egypt. So some important observation to note at this point. I told you earlier that Pharaoh made some choices halfway through this process, but not fully. And here's what it happens. And again, so since we're not going through all the Bible verses, I'll just bring them to you. And it says that at this point, the Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, made 3 noted confessions, very significant confession. The first one, he says, this time he says, I have sinned. King was so adamant about him being God, he said, I have sinned. Second, he says, the Lord is right. And third, he says, I and my people are in the wrong. This one is found in chapter 7 and 9, verses 13 and 35. So, this probably goes there in chapter 9. So, 3 confessions of a king who was so adamant. You would think that confession is good. How many people think confession is good? Okay. But here's what this story teaches us. That confession without having a changed heart is not good. Correct? I don't want to put anybody in spot here, and I don't mean to put, but a lot of times people say, I am going for a confession, or I'm going to confess. But it's only for that day. Next day you start with a clean slate, and you're like, I'm ready for a confession. It doesn't work that way. Confession means your heart has to completely mean it, that I'm not going to do it again. Confession means nothing unless it is followed by a changed heart. And at the end of the day, after Pharaoh confessed that, guess what? He didn't let him go. His heart was hardened. Egyptian plague, next one, is locust sent from the sky, and it affected a god called Seth, Egyptian god of storms and disorder. Okay, this is in chapter 8 and through 10, verse verses 1 through 20 all the way down to chapter 10. A terrifying invasion of locusts. They devoured everything left in the fields that was left after the hail and all of those things. And if you guys know about locusts, you know, think about this whole room filled with green stuff. And if a swarm of locusts came here, in 2 seconds you would not see any green here. Less than 2 seconds, depending on the number of them. But this was like the sky was covered. That's every single green looking thing was gone. Before the locust came, Pharaoh had, the people had, the officials had pleaded to the Pharaoh that let the people go, let them worship the Lord their God. Do you not realize that Egypt is ruined? This is what people are saying, but the Pharaoh offers one more compromise. Again, a little bit, let only men go. Is that something God said? God said everyone. And Pharaoh says, let only men go. But God has never considered the worship of a woman, a worship of a child, any less than worship of a man. God wants everyone to worship him equally. So Moses stretched out his hand over Egypt, and a strong east wind brought a massive cloud of locusts from the Arabian desert. And in a short time, the locusts just took over the land of Egypt. So where was Nimri, the goddess of grain? Pharaoh made another shallow confession. I have sinned against the Lord your God and against you. But that confession only lasted as long as the locusts were there. Once the locusts were gone, they went away. And then the last, not the last, but the last for today. Number 9, 3 days of complete darkness, and it affected the son of the sun god, Ra, the sun god. Darkness that could be felt. Okay? Can you feel darkness? I don't know how. Have you guys ever been in there, that kind of a situation? Darkness, where you can't even see your own hand, kind of thing. Somebody earlier today was saying that it is, or no, actually I heard it somewhere that they are afraid of darkness. They cannot be alone in darkness. And it is true probably for a lot of us, but this was, I mean, the whole country was in darkness. And the terror of darkness fell on the land for 3 days. In terms of Egyptian religion, this was the most significant judgment for the first 9 plagues. Ra, the sun god, and Thoth, the moon god, were nowhere seen in their places. People who were used to seeing gods in their heavenly places, moon, sun, they were nowhere to be seen. The loss of the sun would have been especially painful to Egyptians, for sun worshippers, and especially for the Pharaoh, because remember that he was considered a reincarnation of sun god. That's what he called himself. He was a reincarnation of sun god. He was compared to the one true God. And Pharaoh was like the most important, powerful ruler, but he could not stop. He could not plead to his. The total darkness stopped life. There was no way for them to leave their homes, find food, see each other, do any activity. So Pharaoh offers another compromise. Men, women, and children go and worship your God, but leave your flocks behind. Remember what their Egyptians had lost their flocks, right? So where do you think he's gonna get his wealth back? So you guys can go, but leave your flock behind. And they had a big flock. Remember I said Goshen was very fertile. So leave your flocks behind. But Moses says, not a hoof. Who knows what a hoof is? Not a hoof left behind. It's the bottom part of the animal there. This angered Pharaoh, and he told Moses never to come again in his presence. This is where the 9th plague ended. It got Pharaoh very upset. It left Moses without accomplishing his. So we will talk about the 10th plague when we talk about Passover next Sunday. But just a few closing points I want to tell you from these 9 plagues that we talked about. Pharaoh's hardened heart. A hardened heart is repeatedly hardened even further. And you know, what are we to understand when we read that Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart? Is it the Lord doing that? Like, you know, Pharaoh wants to be nice, but I'm not going to let him be nice. It is not God's doing. I think the real view behind that is sometimes God gives us opportunities. Sometimes God gives us chance to repent. Sometimes God gives us chance to reverse our actions, but we continue to move in the same direction. We continue taking the same steps, and we harden our heart, and then the Lord leaves us be. You know, the Bible says very clearly that hear God while he is near. But one day, if we keep ignoring Him, we may be that far. God remains in His place. We may be that far away from God that we cannot hear His voice. So hear God when He is near. Pharaoh had his chance. He hardened his heart. He didn't want to take any of these opportunities that Moses had given him. And here's the thing that, you know, Christians, for us, we have to consider this. Don't let sometimes the verses that confuse us, like, Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, so Lord didn't allow no Pharaoh to change. And a lot of times we think that it's supreme will of God. But God has given us free will. We are created with free will, right? So God knows what we will do. Our inclination is to be away from God, but in Jesus Christ, we have to be aligned with God. We have to be straight in line with God. And that is the chance He gives to each one of us. So, a couple of applications I will leave you with, and ask yourselves this question. We don't have to answer it now. Here's the first question. Do you agree that there is only one true God? I believe everybody here would say that. As Christians, we say that we believe in God, but many things take God's place in our lives. Are there things that take place of God in your lives? Does it replace God? Is there anything that replaces God? Is it your reputation? What people think about you? Is it your money? Is it your security? Is it your pleasure? I need this time for myself. I need some good time. Is it another person that is replacing God? Is it your idea that I can use my time and talents the way I see fit? That also can become an idol. God will not compromise with idolatry. You have to learn that. There are false gods that we have to fight today. Just like God fought that battle and won, you would know that. But we have to also fight the false god. False gods do not go by the names of God, but anything opposing God is a false god, is an idol. You know, godless philosophies, Greek people were very famous. They just sat around like, well, what if? What if that cloud was a god? What if? There was a lot of these philosophies that people do. Just idle, sitting idle, thinking about that. Extreme nationalism. Sometimes I'm guilty of that. You know, lately on 15th August, we saw extreme nationalism. Every clip I was getting was about India and Vande Mataram. You know, or sometimes people may do it about American independence. So extreme, when that takes place of God, extreme nationalism, it can also be a secularism, can that be do that? Humanism, when you take that to another extreme, could be a materialism, obviously. All of these can be idols. But just as Moses opposed the God of Egypt, do you oppose these false gods that come around in our lives? Are you fighting against God in some area in your life? Ask yourself that question tonight before you go to bed. Is there something I'm fighting that I need to let go? I need to surrender completely to God. And that has to happen in a closed door between you and God. It doesn't happen in a family prayer. It doesn't happen in a public place like this. It will happen. Find a closet. If you don't have a private place in your room, go in a closet. Close yourself. Just say, God, you know, this is the thing that I'm struggling with. I want you to win that victory for me. I cannot do it on my own. You cannot compromise with God. Pharaoh tried to compromise with God a few times, but it did not work. God is sovereign, and those who oppose Him will be broken at the end. So will you give yourself wholly, completely, solely? If you do so, you will find Him that He is powerful. If you do so, you will find Him that He is loving. If you do so, you will find Him wonderful. If you do so, you will find Him wisdomful. You'll just find everything. Everything that you're looking for, you'll find in this God. And lastly, as we are going to go next week to that crusade, Harvest Crusade, I want to ask you about this. Do you have a friend that does not believe in this true God? Do you have a friend that is in a culture that worships other idols? Do you know of a friend that is just following some totally different thing, to other gods? He's making his gifts to other gods, giving gifts of food in the name of other gods, whatever he may be doing, but not in the name of the one true God. And just as Moses became stronger in the Lord and spoke truthfully to the most powerful king, I think that if you obey and speak truth, God will be with you. You will free that one person out of that captivity, and that is what we need to pray. A response of obedience draws you closer to God. Obedience, very important. Response of obedience draws you closer to God and strengthens your faith. So if you are disobedient, you can see the other, right? If obedience draws you closer to God, you can only imagine what the disobedience would do to us, right? So remember this, let us pray. I'm going to invite the band to lead us in the worship. And as you bring your offering, remember that the need that we have, I think I keep saying that, and we're still working at it. We need another speaker like this, and we're short a few more dollars. We are very close to getting one. We want two, and as you will see how good they sound, we're going to do it for that. But more important than that, I just want to have one last verse. Come on, come on. But I just want to leave you with this. If you do confess, make sure that your heart follows that. I just want to make sure, don't say sorry and don't mean it. It does not bring reconciliation. I think some of us elders would know. Remember, like, yeah, go ahead. I think I want to add really, because it is, you know, apra samajma. I will switch to Gujarati since apra samajma ani bhu jarur chhe. Apne jare nana hata ne, apna father ne bandra apne su kehta tha, sorry kid. How many of you have heard that? Papa apne kehta tha, chal sorry kid. Well, sorry. Even the kavichan apne sorry. Okay, sorry. But pachi apne jo khara mama apne pacha pote tha, hum nahi. Barabar manto even the kid, right? અને આઈ થિંક આપણા સંબંધોમાં જે તિરાડ પડે છે, આપણા રિલેશન્સમાં જે પ્રોબ્લેમ થાય છે, એ આના માટે થાય છે કે ઘણી વાર આપણે સોરી કહીએ છીએ પણ બહુ ઉપર છલકો હોય છે. અને ઇટ હેઝ ટુ કમ. હું તમને એક દાખલો આપું કે અમારા બાઇબલ સ્ટડીમાં સોરી હું બીજી બે મિનિટ લેવા માંગુ છું, કારણ કે બહુ જ ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ આ વસ્તુ છે. અને હું એવી આશા રાખું છું કે વી વિલ સ્પ્રેડ ધીસ ટુ અધર પીપલ, કે જ્યારે તમે કન્ફેસ કરો કે સોરી કહો ને, કન્ફેસ તો આપણે પ્રભુની આગળ કરીએ, પણ કોઈને સોરી કહો. So don't just say, I'm sorry. મેં તમને ગઈકાલે કંઈ કર્યું હોય અને જસ્ટ સોરી નહીં, એનો ગઈકાલે મેં તને ફોન ના કર્યો અને એને લીધે તારો પ્લાનમાં તને મુશ્કેલી થઈ, મેં તને બે કલાક રાહ જોવડાવી, માથે ના હોય મને ખરેખર આઈ વિલ મેક શ્યોર ધેટ આઈ નેવર ડુ ધેટ અગેન. હેડ સમ મીનિંગફુલ ધેટ હી નોઝ ધેટ આઈ મીન, રાઈટ? નહીં તો પછી આવતી વખતે બી મોડું થાય, ઓકે આઈ એમ સોરી. સો વી હેવ ટુ નો વોટ વી આર સોરી ફોર, ધી અધર પર્સન હેઝ ટુ નો. So let's do that. We need to go back to our clip, but anyway, thank you again for giving me some extra time and being here. It is the darkness, and we want you to take over and remove that darkness, remove that plague from our lives, Lord, and make our hearts pure, clear, presentable to you, Lord. When the day we stand in front of you, Lord, that we would be able to lift our heads, stand in front of you, and receive that blessing that you will occur upon us, and say that, well done, my good and faithful servant. Well done, my good and faithful servant. We want to hear those words. So prepare us for this time. Use this offering. Use our lives for your honor and glory. Use this ministry for your honor and glory. And we just pray, Lord, that today would be a new beginning for each one of us sitting here. We ask this again in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And we ask, Lord, that your love and your grace, and we ask that amazing power that we have in the Christ Jesus, the Savior's name, and we ask that fellowship that we have in the Holy Spirit, wherever we may be with us, be with all God's children until Jesus Christ returns again. And in His name we ask. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, worship team. Awesome.